Welcome back to Mr. Spectre. Today I'm gonna explain and recap the movie Fracture, 2007, buckle up, spoiler ahead and let's begin. Theodore Ted Crawford is a wealthy Irish aeronautical engineer living in Los Angeles. His work included finding the tiniest fractures in aircraft systems. After showing his colleague a plane fault he had found, Ted quickly left without waiting for the algorithm to confirm. What follows is a scene of a couple having an affair, the man being Lieutenant Rob Nunally and the woman being Ted's wife, Jennifer Crawford. Both are married and Lieutenant Nunally said he wanted to live with Jennifer because he fell in love with her, which caused Jennifer to change her expression and become a bit worried. Ted stopped the car on the side of the road. He made a phone call to confirm when Lieutenant Nunally would be back at headquarters. Ted then entered the motel ahead, where his wife was having an affair, after seeing his wife out in the pool with her mistress. Ted unlocked a room and walked in, looking around. The next scene, Ted's wife is driving home, and after she enters the house, suddenly from the dark, Ted greets her while standing next to his DIY rolling ball sculptures. Ted talking to his wife, we can see that Ted's wife doesn't like him at one point, that he is too smart. As for Ted, intelligence and knowledge sometimes make him helpless. Ted kisses his wife, but she's not really interested and says she's going to make dinner. Ted questions her about her affair. Jennifer apologizes but Ted says no need. He suddenly pulled out a gun and shot his wife in the head when she turned around. His gardeners heard the gunfire, came closer to check. Ted fired a few more shots, scaring them and making them run away. Ted then wiped the cartridges on the ground, burned the shirt he was wearing, and cleaned his body. The police arrived after the gardeners reported the incident. Among them was Lieutenant Nunally as a hostage negotiator. He called Ted and after knowing it was the lieutenant, he opened the door. After negotiating, both Ted and the lieutenant agreed to put down their guns. Ted then calmly told the lieutenant that he had shot his wife. The lieutenant was taken aback and walked over to where Ted had pointed his wife was lying. Nunally couldn't stand up when he discovered it was his mistress. He fell to his knees to check the pulse in his neck. Ted said casually, as far as he knew, the best pulse to check was in the femoral artery. Ted stepped forward and pointed the gun at Nunally. In anger, Nunally snatched the gun and lunged at Ted. Nunally punched Ted repeatedly in the face but was stopped by the other policemen as they rushed in. Ted was caught and taken away by the police. The medic said that Jennifer was still breathing and Ted calmly watched as he was handcuffed by the police. We are introduced to the next character, William Willie Beecham. He is a rising star deputy district attorney. Willie is leaving his job as a district attorney to join a large law firm called Wooten Sims. His boss calls him up to congratulate him, but he still believes that Wooten Sims wouldn't be suitable for Willie. Staying here is more suitable for Willie. He just disagrees because he is too hyped up to be at Wooten Sims. Willie's co-workers call him about Ted's attempted murder case. Knowing the weapon, the witnesses are both available, even Ted's confession. Willie believes this will be an open and shut case, so he agreed to take it immediately. At the preliminary hearing, Ted did not ask for a defense attorney because he would act as his own attorney. Both the judge and Willie were surprised that he was in a very disadvantageous position, and they advised him to retain his right to use a defense attorney. However, Ted was determined not to use it, and then he asked to be transferred to the trial as soon as possible. When told that the district attorney's office could change prosecutors during the trial, Ted said he liked Willie, which took Willie by surprise. Later, Lieutenant Nunally went to Willie to warn him that there was something strange about Ted, but Willie remains confident that with the available evidence and confessions, there is nothing to worry about. At a black tie event of Wooden Sims that Willie was invited to earlier, he met Nikki Gardner, who introduced himself as his boss when he arrived at Wooden Sims. Willie intends to flirt with Nikki, and she is quite impressed that Willie is introduced by Bert Wooden, the owner of the law firm himself. Their conversation was interrupted by a phone call from Willie's colleague. The first suspicious point, the weapon they got from Ted's house had never been fired before. Ted didn't come out at all after committing the crime until he was caught, so there is absolutely no chance that he can change weapons. The next morning, Willie went to the scene to check. He learned that there was no gunpowder on Ted's body and hands, the cartridge was missing 4 rounds, and on the 4 cartridges there were no fingerprints, especially a gun that has never been fired. The detective confirms to Willie that Ted is intending to play them. Willie doesn't mind any of that. He insists that the gun is still in the house because he hasn't gone out, tells his friend to keep looking and then Willie leaves. When Willie returned to his office, he received a file, which was the evidence files for Ted's case that he had legally sent to Ted. When he opened it, Willie discovered that every page had a no written on it with a red pen. Willie goes to find Ted and surprised when he reads Willie like a book. He has used his right to investigate Willie himself. Ted also teases Willie when he invites him to become his defense attorney, saying that gives him a chance to switch sides before things go bad. Willie finds it all ridiculous, so he decides to leave. Before he left, however, Ted told Willie a story about when he was a child. His egg farmer father asked him to check the eggs and put the bad and flawed ones in the bakery bucket. Ted put in 300 eggs because he found bad spots and flaws in all of them. Ted tells Willie that we can find weakness in everything if we look closely enough. Willie curiously asks if Ted has found his weakness. Ted says that Willie's weakness is that he's the winner, and Willie just smiles and walks away. At the trial, Willie called witnesses in turn to ask questions. Ted calmly sat down to draw some designs, not paying attention to the testimony of the witnesses, and Ted did not come up to ask questions when it was his turn. Willie called Lieutenant Nunally to act as a witness, and while he was reporting Ted's confession, Ted objected to Lieutenant Nunnally's testimony. When asked, Ted replied that Nunally was having an affair with his wife. This shocked the court. Willie knew he was trapped. He said he wanted to talk to the lieutenant, but he just went straight to Ted and lunged at him. The trial had to be put on recess. Willie, Ted, and the judge sat down together. Ted has evidence of the motel where Nunally and Jennifer had an affair, because he hired a private investigator to investigate. And since Lieutenant Nunally was present when Ted signed the confession, Ted reasoned that the presence of his wife's lover had led to the signing. The judge decided to give Willie a few days. If he didn't have new evidence, Ted could go home. When he returned to the office, Willie's boss took the initiative to wait for him. He said that because Willie was too absorbed in thinking about a new job, a new salary. Willie arrived at the trial unprepared, but Willie himself had nothing to worry about as he was about to leave. This case will be passed on to someone else, so Willie won't be known for his bitter defeat. Willie still tried to explain that it was a setup, but his boss's words made him really think. Willie then goes to see Nikki. He is surprised to learn that she protected him today, when Bert wanted to fire Willie after he learned of the trial. Willie and Nikki got really into each other and then had a good night. He thanked her before leaving. When he got home, he received a parcel with an eggshell in it. This angered Willie, and the next morning he went to his boss's room. Willie tells him that he will work this case to the end. His boss advises him that he should leave, because if this case fails, not only Willie will surely lose his job at the new law firm but also in this office. His boss couldn't keep him either. Willie agrees because he believes someone like Ted needs to be incarcerated. Willie goes to the police station and blames his friend for not finding the real gun. The detective does not react strongly and agrees to help Willie check the house one last time. Willie went to see the lieutenant, but he was now too exhausted. His wife, when she heard about it, took the child to her mother's house. Reporters gathered a lot in front of the lieutenant's house. Willie achieved absolutely nothing. He went to the motel where the affair happened, and was informed that he would get the CCTV of the day Ted went there soon. Willie then goes to Ted's office and receives a phone call from him. Ted continues to mock Willie's efforts. Then he went to Ted's house and learned the police couldn't find anything else. Willie looked at the house helplessly. Everything came to a standstill. Willie comes to the hospital to wait for a miracle that Jennifer will wake up. A doctor walks in and tells him that it's highly unlikely that happened. Even if Jennifer woke up, she wouldn't be able to speak, let alone remember who shot her. Later, Willie is invited to the house for a meal with Nikki's family, the case being mentioned during the meal and mocked by Nikki's brother. But she says it's okay because Willie doesn't do it anymore. Willie admits that he will continue to do this case. This made Nikki both surprised and angry. The two talk privately. Nikki says that the problem is not Willie coming back to the case, the problem is Willie can't follow the orders. He won't be able to fit into an incorporation if he doesn't. Also, his action affects not only Willie but also Nikki because she has protected him. Willie stubbornly says that he never asked her to defend him in front of Bert. Nikki leaves indignantly. Her father, a judge, giving him encouragement that the interesting part of the work of people like them is to leave a great wound for the bad guys. Willie immediately returned to work. That night, the lieutenant found Willie and he offered to plant fake evidence, but Willie disagreed. The next day, Willie received the CCTV footage, but he was wearing a hat, so it wasn't enough to testify in court. Willie and the detective argue because Willie thinks the gun is still there and the police can't find it. His friend thought that the evidence Ted was at the motel on the day of the crime was enough. Then Willie angrily leaves. Still unable to find a new direction, Willie sadly went to the hospital and waited for Jennifer to wake up. The next day, before the trial begins, Willie uses a trick. He asks his secretary when she receives his phone call to pretend to come in and whisper in his ear about finding new evidence. She agrees. As soon as the trial got underway, Ted moved a judgment of acquittal. It means the defendant argues that no reasonable jury could possibly find guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. A defendant can ask a judge to acquit on all of the charges or just some of them. Since this was perfectly valid, the judge asked Willie if he had new evidence. Willie actually wanted to call, but then realized it would all be in vain because Ted was too smart to be fooled by a trick. The judge granted Ted's judgment of acquittal and he was released. Willie looked down sadly. Only Willie was left sitting in the court. Nikki called to comfort him when a gunshot was heard. Willie ran out and stood dumbfounded looking at the lieutenant, who had killed himself on the steps. On the other side, Ted looked over but didn't seem to care. Ted was released and back at his home with his gun. Willie continued to sit in the hospital praying for Jessica to wake up. The next morning, Ted shows up at the hospital and tells Willie that he'd better treat him good rather than his wife, because legally he's still Jessica's husband. He could have given her a humane death if he wants to. Willie is extremely worried. He rushes to Nikki's place and asks her for help even though she has nothing to do with it. Nikki says he shouldn't be here and she can't help him. Willie continues to follow her and tells her that Ted was about to kill his wife and block the elevator door. Nikki coldly asks what does that have to do with this law firm, and the elevator door slowly closed just like their relationship. Willie goes back to his boss and learns that Ted has placed a restraining order against him on the grounds that Willie frequently comes to Jessica's hospital room. His boss advises him to stop and take care of himself because Ted is already a free citizen. Willie had no choice but to go to Nikki's father, who signed an order for him to stop Ted from pulling Jessica's breathing tube. But by the time Willie got to the hospital, Ted had already done it. The sound of the life support and the image of Willie getting held on the ground tells viewers that evil still prevails. The next day, while cleaning the garage, Willie's boss came to him and asked him to go back to work. Willie asks his boss if he's scared. His boss says he's not afraid because it's his office anyway, at least until the next election. But in the end, Willie still refuses. Willie feels guilty for letting a guy get away with murder, but his boss jokes that it's actually an attempted murder. This gave Willie an idea. Willie didn't give up. He turned around and continued reading the legal documents, reviewing the evidence and going to his detective friend. When they put their phones next to each other, the detective accidentally picked up Willie's phone because the two were identical. It was a mocking Willie phone call from Ted, which made Ted realize something and he showed it to the detective. As Ted was about to leave, Willie arrived at his house. Willie uncovers all the tricks Ted used. First he buys a gun that looks exactly like Nunally's, then he goes to the motel to swap the two guns. Ted then goes home and kills his wife. When the lieutenant discovers Jennifer lying on the ground causing him to lose his temper, and Ted swaps the gun again. So the lieutenant actually helped him get the weapon out of the scene. Ted laughed, admitting what Willie said was accurate and mocking the lieutenant for carrying the weapon they had been searching so hard for during the trial, and then used it to kill himself. Ted said he just used one bullet and killed two of those bad people. Ted continued that Willie could not prosecute Ted even if he had evidence, because the same person cannot be prosecuted twice for the same crime. However, it was Willie who got the last laugh when he said that because Ted had let Jennifer die, Willie could get the bullet from her head to match it with the lieutenant's gun and then prosecute him for first-degree murder, which would be a new charge. Willie also added that if Ted left her alone, Jennifer would outlive both Ted and Willie, according to the doctor. Then the police came in to arrest Ted. The film ends with a trial scene where Willie is still alone, but Ted is surrounded by many lawyers from the Wooden Sims law firm. What a great movie! I think Willie's problem was that he was too arrogant and thought this was an easy case, despite the strange signs. Plus, Willie didn't think the problem was with him but with the others, so most of the time he blamed it on the police and desperately held on to a miracle that Jessica will wake up, instead of digging deeper into the case. After losing, Willie let go of his ego, really digging into the case that helped him succeed. As for Ted, he committed the crime almost perfectly. But he really wants it to be perfect, to be able to call it killing both of them with one bullet. He made a fatal mistake of letting his wife die, which made the table turn. And that was the movie. I really hope you enjoyed it. I'm Mr. Spectre and I will see you in the next one. Bye bye.